sing of the wondrous story of Jesus who died for me. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How he left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. I was lost, but Jesus found me, found the sheep that went astray, raised me up and gently led me back into the narrow way. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. Thank you, Lord, for dying on the cross for me. Was bruised, but Jesus healed me. Faint was I from many a fall. Sight was gone, and fears possessed me. But he freed me from them all. Yes, I'll sing the story of the Christ who died for me. Sing it with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. Days of darkness still come o'er me, so I often dread, but the Savior still is with me. By his hand I'm safely led. Hallelujah. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the praise the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me praise his holy name. Hallelujah. He will keep me till the river rolls its waters at my feet. Then he'll bear me safely over the story of the
welcome again to another episode of your favorite Hymns Unlimited broadcast, The Harp for short, with Ataa Nii. And I'm so excited to come your way again with another hour of reflection, you know, as we reflect on the hymn that was just rendered beautifully by the minstrel Gifty Asaam. You know, yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. And I'm excited to tell you that on this episode, we are blessed to have as our special guest, you know, to reflect with me on this hymn, a versatile musician, composer, and instrumentalist who's contributed immensely to church music in Africa and the United States, who has interest in theology and music in Christian education, the one who founded the Methodist Evangel Choir and came out with several albums. Most of your favorite songs are from him. Your Grace and Mercy is one that is on the hearts of many. I'm excited to let you know that today on The Harp, I get to welcome again for this season 2, Reverend Newlove Annan. Reverend Newlove, welcome.
Thank you very much, Pastor.
And thanks for making the time. You're a very busy man. Thanks for making the time to be with us today. Yes. And
I'm happy to be here with you.
Okay. Awesome. And just gone by was a rendition of, yes, I'll sing the wondrous story. I'll sing the wondrous story written by Francis Harold Rowley in 1854 by Gifty Asaam. How do you find the rendition?
The rendition was beautiful. I mean, it was coolly done. I always say that I enjoy all kinds of renditions of different kinds of music, but the one that really ministers, I think for sure, is the one that is done by a single person. Ataa Nii, you agree with me as a musician that when it happens like that, you can hear the text clearly.
That's it.
Yes, and everything comes out very well. And she sang from her heart. I like the accompaniment and the key change also. There was a point where they changed the key. It suited the words there very much. So I really enjoyed that rendition.
Thank you. I hope Gifty is listening. The music professor himself is saying you did so well. Gifty is one of my singers who is really, she loves that song, Your Grace and Mercy. She actually has done a rendition of it with Reverend Benissel. You absolutely love it. But today, our focus is on this powerful hymn. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. So I'll let you start us off maybe with the first verse or your opening reflections on this particular hymn.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ataa Nii. And it's a joy to be with you once again. And I'd like to thank God for your life, for the wonderful work that you are doing, for the promotion of music in worship and all of that. We pray that God gives you long life, so that you are able to do more of what you are doing.
Amen.
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 So this is a wonderful hymn. And thank you also for putting me in the spirit, because before the recording, I heard you humming the hymn and it was putting me in the spirit. So thank you very much for that. So I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. Me particularly, I think that this hymn should be the anthem of the church musicians, if we were to come together to have anybody like that, because it suggests that we should use singing or music to talk about the story of the cross, if you agree with me.
I do.
So in other words, the verb sing or the word sing that is used here in this hymn is lifting up a tested and a trusted medium for making the wondrous story of Christ known to the world. It says that we should sing the story, that wondrous story of the cross. Mm. Now, I'd like to talk about the using music or singing as a way of telling the story of the cross or of God's story in general.
Okay.
It's been said that the energy of any artwork, because you know that music is art, right?
That's
singing
it.
Is art.
Yeah.
Yes. They say that the energy of any artwork actually rests on the energy that the artwork points to.
Oh, wow.
So, for instance, if you see a painting of a mother carrying a baby at her back, what you are seeing immediately is a picture of a woman carrying a baby at her back. But actually, it's pointing to a motherhood, it's pointing to a lot of things beyond the picture that you are seeing.
Wow.
So it is said that the energy that of any artwork actually points to what the artwork is pointing to and not the artwork itself. So we believe when it comes to Christian music or singing our faith, that we are actually pointing to something bigger than the music that we are singing or what we are hearing.
Wow.
And that is the word of God.
Mm.
And in this instance, the is telling us that we should sing, we should use the beauty of music, we should use the gift, the power of music, not to do anything else but to talk about the story of the cross. So first, let's look at the cross.
Okay.
I listed about 10 things about the cross. You know, the cross can generate a whole lot of, you know, discussion.
That's
and
it.
Theological, discourse here and there, but I've listed 10 simple things that we would look at when it comes to the cross. First of all, the cross is Trinitarian.
That's
the cross is Trinitarian. So we are talking here about God the Father sending the Son to save the world, and the Son being submitted or being submissive to the Father's will, and the Spirit being applied to the work of redemption to Jesus's followers. So in this way, we look at three things.
Okay.
Sending. When we talk about the cross, we are talking about sending. We are being, just as Jesus was sent, we are also being sent to do something. And we're also talking about submission. We are also talking about submission. Anytime you think about the cross, you are also thinking about submission. And anytime we think about the cross, we are also thinking about that big aspect of Jesus's ministry, and that is what the Holy Spirit does in order to put us in line with what Jesus did. And here we can read Ephesians 1, 3 to 6, Ephesians 1, 7 to 10, Ephesians 1, 13 to 14, and so on. And the second point is the cross is the center of the story of the scripture. The cross is the center of the story of the scripture.
Okay.
So people say that the New Testament is the Old Testament fulfilled, and the Old Testament is the New Testament revealed. So there's no contradiction here or there. The cross completes the story of the entire Bible. Sometimes people say that, the Old Testament is also important, this is also important, as if one is doing something different from what the other is doing. No, the cross comes to fulfill everything that began from Genesis. Yes.
Wow.
So the cross is the center of the story of the scripture. Now, the third one, I think I'll just talk about three and then you come in, and then if there's time, I'll continue.
Yeah.
Now, the cross redefines power in the kingdom. The cross redefines power in the kingdom. You know that God gave the power to Adam and Eve, but then they went ahead of themselves. They wanted to take the power into their own hands when you read Genesis 3 and 5. But then God comes in again to save us. So the story of the cross, as we call it in Greek, is what we call the euangelion, the good news. And that is what the author of the hymn is saying, that we should use music to point to that power, because music has that kind of power to put people's attention on something that is greater than itself. So in this case, the author is saying that we should think about the cross, because the good news the beautiful good news that we have, that blessed good news that we have, is centered on the cross. So that's what makes me love this hymn.
By way of introduction. I like this introduction because it's just drawing me into a very topical issue. You know, you said we should use music to tell the story. We should use music to tell the story. Would you say that is gospel music? Is that what gospel music is set to achieve?
Very good question. You know that we've been going back and forth on this, what gospel music is and what gospel music is. And last time, I remember that in our previous conversation, you were talking about the American pastor who sang Love is the Message.
Yes.
And some SU people had problems with it and that kind of thing. This thing has gone on and on and on. You know, even during the time of Luther, Martin Luther had a problem with pastors who were writing songs that were not based on scriptures.
Yes.
Actually, it was Zwingli who had that problem.
Okay.
That people were writing songs that were not based on scripture. They were divided. Some thought that if you write music, you should take the words directly from scripture and set it to music. Others thought that, you could do a reflection on the words in the Bible, you know, when you sing a song like Bononi, or when you sing a song like cannot be found directly in scripture, but it's a reflection, you know, on scripture. It's also considered gospel music. So to answer your question, gospel music, I believe, should be any kind of music that is backing the message of the cross. And here, I like this hymn because it centers the whole message of the Bible on the cross. When you center the whole message on the cross, it works perfectly well because the cross is what completes everything that the Bible is there to do. Because without the cross, we will have a Bible that has no ending or that has no solution to any problem. So gospel music, I believe, is any kind of music that backs the message of the cross.
So inadvertently we are saying that I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. It's talking about we using the power of music to tell the story of the gospel.
Yes, yes, yes. In that case, it means that the author is helping us reflect on scripture to define what music in worship or music in Christianity should be more concerned about. That is backing the power of the message of the cross.
Beautiful.
That is what our concern should be about.
Beautiful. If you just joined us, I'm here with Reverend Newlove Annan. We are reflecting on the hymn, I'll Sing the Wondrous Story, written way back in 1854 and still one of the favorites in the Orthodox faith, in the evangelical faith. I mean, anytime this hymn is raised, I see people like men in men's fellowship, some with tears in their eyes, you know, just singing from their hearts, because the words are central to our faith, just like Reverend Newlove has just expanded on. And you said something, you said worship in music. You know, I live in an era where people substitute music for worship and worship for music.
Music, yes.
You know, but you put it right. You said music in worship. And so what is the role of music in worship? Is music worship? Is worship music? If you can just throw some light on that, then we can go back to our reflection.
All right. So, music in worship is any kind of music that we find as appropriate or wholesome, I mean, to be used in the context of worship. We cannot substitute music for worship. It's unfortunate some people feel that music is an end to itself when we come to worship. But music is backing a main event, and that is God's word. Now, you know that the worship started gradually. God did not just come out one day and say, here's how you should worship. It started gradually. He started calling Abraham out of his father's house. He started asking people to erect altars. And here we can talk about two different kinds of altar. You talk about the altar of incense and the altar of sacrifice.
That's it.
There's one that you sacrifice on, and there's one that you burn incense on. So when it comes to music, I think that we fit into the altar of incense more, because we send that kind fragrance up through worship. So it must come from the heart. And someone has also said that the Bible is God's letter to us. And our music, our sing during worship is also our reply to that letter that God has written to us.
Wow.
As we find in the Bible. So when we are worshiping and we are singing, we are sending incense, you know, to God. So we have the altar of sacrifice and we have the altar of incense. So they go hand in hand. Music itself cannot stand in for worship in totality, because worship is bigger than that.
That's
worship.
It.
Yes, worship has to do with prayer. Worship has to do with listening to the word of God. Worship has to do with so many fellowship and so many other things. And music is that aspect of worship. If we are to go back then to the prototypes that I mentioned to you, being the altar of incense and the altar of sacrifice, and I'll say that we have two altars all going up at the same time, God receiving all the two at the same time. Music is happening on the one that is of incense. So that is where we send what is in our hearts to God. We express it in another way that he showed us how to do. Because when you read Job chapter 38, verse 7, it says that at the beginning, the whole of creation sang, and the angels also shouted for joy, which means that music has been there since beginning of time. So God himself showed us how to use this medium to send that incense of worship to him.
Wow, this imagery you are giving us is so, I don't want to say deep. it's so graphic. You know, this is incense. You know, sweet perfume, sweet savor.
Yes.
You know that that should bring whoever is taking it in some pleasure, some glory.
Exactly.
Some wow. And I like the fact that, you know, you started off by saying that he started introducing us to worship gradually, because, you know, we have to take time to understand it. So he started it off gradually. And then when we got the understanding, then there was a man called David who came, who now expanded it into a tabernacle. And I'm just enjoying this. I'm just enjoying this.
Exactly me.
Let's go for a spot of music. Let's go back and listen to the rendition of I will sing the Wondrous Story again by Minister Gifty Asaam, and then when we come, we'll dive deeper into the hymn.
Yes.
I will sing of the wondrous story of Jesus who died for me. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How he left his home in glory for the cross of Calvary. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ. Was lost, but Jesus found me, found the sheep that went. strength, raise me up and gently let me back into the narrow way. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, singing with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. Dying on the cross for me. Hallelujah. Hey, yeah. I was bruised, but Jesus healed me. From many a fall, sight was gone, and fears possessed me, but he freed me from them all. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ. Days of darkness still come o'er me, sorrow's paths I often tread, but the Savior still is with me. By his hand I'm safely led. Hallelujah. Yes, I'll sing your story of the Christ who died for me, singing with the saints in glory, gathered by the crimson sea. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And all that is within me praises holy name. Hallelujah. He will keep me till the river rolls its waters at my feet. Then he'll bear me safely over.
No sea.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Such
hallelujah.
A blessing. Such a blessing. So we are still on the Hymns Unlimited broadcast with Ataa Nii, and I'm honored to have Reverend Newlove Annan with me, and we are reflecting on the hymn, I Will Sing the Wondrous Story, written by Francis Harold Rowley in 1854, and still being a blessing to us. So back to you, Newlove. Any verse that sticks out to you, you know, listening to the hymn again, any verse you want to focus on next?
All the verses, Attorney. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me.
Yeah.
Sing it with the saint in glory, guarded by the crystal sea.
Wow.
Wonderful story, Pastor. Wonderful story. In fact, the cross has done a lot. And as we are discussing, I think that if you have not come to that reality where the cross means a lot to you, all that we are talking about will not mean anything. Mm. And I think that you agree with me on that. You know, the cross, as I was saying, I talked about three things earlier. The cross inaugurates the new covenant. You know, it does inaugurate the new covenant, because Jesus said that he poured out his blood and his body was, you know, he was beaten and all of that for us to create a new community. So in as much as we should be happy for what Jesus has done for us, we should not also, you know, belittle what he has done. For us, you know, so it's a great thing. The cross is a great thing, and the cross also conquers sin and death. So we should be very happy when we talk about the cross. The song is also talking about that. The cross vanquishes the devil. The cross vanquishes the devil. The cross is substitutionary. As you know, it stands in for us. The cross is foolishness to the world, because it's only Christianity that subscribe to this kind of idea that our God, the God that we hold so high, was actually went through suffering and died such a disgraceful death.
Yeah.
So the cross becomes foolish to the world, but that is the wisdom of God, and we should be happy about that. The cross brings peace, reconciliation, and unity. The cross is the marching order for Christians, because Jesus said that whoever is going to follow me must deny himself and take up the cross and follow me. And so this is what the hymnist is talking about. And to, you know, complete the answer to your question about which verse stuck up to me, you know, if you study the hymn very well, you find out that the hymnist is not only talking about what the cross has done for you, but it's also talking about after here, after life, how you join with those who have lived and have gone before us, you know, how we will unite with them, and also the cross will still count there, even at that point. You know, the cross will still make meaning to us, or we will be filled with praise for what the cross has done for us after here. So it keeps on saying that when the water roll at my feet, that's when the end of time has come for you. It says when we meet with those who are the other side of the sea and all of that. So the hymn is very deep, because it's not only talking about what the cross has done for us now in our lives, but it's also talking about those who have gone before us and those who even come after us. You know, how the cross is going to work throughout history and life.
Wow. I mean, this is like a full sermon. This is a full sermon. Oh, wow. As you were speaking, I realized, you know, the first verse is saying, I will sing the wondrous story, like an introduction to what I'm coming to sing about. Then the verse 2 lays the foundation for our redemption. I was lost, but Jesus
found me.
Then the verse 3 talks about, you know, he didn't just find us, he also justified us. I was bruised, Jesus healed me. So when we come into Jesus, we come to taste, you know, of his awesome grace and miraculous power. Then he also talks about days of darkness still come over me. You understand? So when you come to faith and you experience his miraculous power and everything, doesn't mean that days of darkness are over. It says it will still come over me. Sorrow's path I often tread, but the Savior is still with me. By his arms I'm safely led. Then, like you rightly said, he says that he will keep me till the river.
Yes.
You know, so it's a whole lifelong journey, and beyond the river, you know, when the
beyond
saints
the river
have gathered. So I mean, this is the gospel, you know, just summarized in 5 verses.
Yes. It's a gospel in 5 verses, as you have said. And you also talk about when you are what did he say? When you are in difficulty or when you are in darkness.
Yes.
That line that you read.
It says that days of darkness still come over me. You know, people think that when you come into the faith, then that is it. It's pure bliss, enjoyment, prosperity, and all that. But it's saying that though I've been found in him, I was bruised, I've been healed and all that, still there are days of darkness that still come.
Yes.
I often pass through sorrows, but the Savior is still with me.
Yes. I like that. I'm looking for, I think it's in either Exodus 31:19 or Leviticus 31:19. I'm trying to find it. There was a time when God called Moses into the forest when the people were traveling, and God said that I am going to give you a song. I don't know if you've read that one before. He said, write out this song and teach it to the people of Israel. Anytime I read that, I'm amazed that God will ask Moses to write out this song, which means self-write songs, right? Songs come into his head and he gives it to man. In fact, all the songs that we sing, church, all the songs that you have composed came from God.
It came from
him. He wrote them himself and he gave them to you through inspiration. And one of the things that God told him, he said, teach it to the people of Israel so that when they have had their fail, they will not forget about me. And also when things are not going the way it should, I'm not using the exact words, but in essence, that's what he's saying. They will sing the song and also remember that I still have a covenant with them, which means that God gives us songs so that they will serve as a witness that if he has brought us through something before, he will bring us through any difficult time that we are facing at the moment. So the cross, like you said, is there to remind us of what Christ did for us, and also to keep us close to Christ, and also for us to know that he is also leading the way. So in times of difficulty, we should not be afraid, or we should not feel that we are alone or by ourselves, but we should still have the confidence that Christ is with us. That's what the cross is there for.
Yeah, and thank you very much. That means that we cannot take the cross out of the gospel.
Yes, we cannot take the cross out of the gospel. The Bible without the cross is like a big book without any solution at the end. You know, that's how it should look like. Yes, because then we will talk about people traveling from here to here in 40 years, people going through this, someone loved by God and giving everything, and he going to commit adultery here and taking somebody's... We will read the stories like that, but it will not come with any solution at the end. So I feel that the cross, if you like, it's like a mathematical, you know, thing that you've written there 13 times, this times that. But then the cross is what is bringing the answer after the is equal to sign. So that's what is going to make the whole thing complete.
That's it. It's interesting that in these days, there are other teachings coming up that seek to say that, okay, the cross has done its work, and so there shouldn't be any connotation of the cross in the kingdom life. You know, Jesus has paid the price, has paid it all, and so we are supposed to live more or less rent-free. We shouldn't be going through any hardship anymore because he's done it for us. We are supposed to be seated with him in heavenly places, you know, and there's nothing like sin anymore. You can't talk about sin. I'm telling you, some very, very strange doctrines coming. I don't know if you've heard of any of these.
Yes, I have. A young lady was telling me recently that she doesn't like praying about forgiveness of sin, because it means that, you know, God has to forgive you all the time and then you go and do it again. So you pray for forgiveness of sin only once and that is it. People have all kinds of teaching going on now. But, you know, I'm a Methodist and you are too by birth. So I'll talk about Methodist catechism. It's talking about the mark.
Yeah.
Wesley is always talking about the mark, the mark that is there, that should serve as the yardstick for you. So the cross should be there to remind us when we sin, when we go off, the cross is there to remind us. So it never finishes its work. It has finished once and for all there, but it's there, like you said, to serve as something that's going to be a mark for us so that you know when you should not take it lightly what Christ has done for you. So that you know when you should shout and praise God for what Christ has done for you on the cross. It's there for us as the mark.
Yeah.
So, well, it's finished its work on Mount Calvary. It did, but it's still there for us, like you said, as something that stands before us, so that we see it as the mark that should guide us as to where we should go and where we should not go.
That's it. That's it. And for me, it makes this hymn stand out for every believer. I keep saying that the hymns have preserved the true doctrines of the church, because as for interpretation, as for the homilies, they come and go. People will come back and say that, oh, I was wrong, I've gotten a new revelation and all
exactly.
But the hymns the hymns are a memorial for us to always go back and realize where we've come from, where we met the Lord, and what has assured us of eternal life. And so you can't move away from that centrality of the gospel. And so for me, for anything to become a hymn, it is something that actually preserves the true doctrine of the church. And I find that this hymn is one hymn, if you don't even know how to witness to anybody about Christ, if you sing through the hymn, the verses, the person should be able to appreciate the totality of the gospel. You know, the person will appreciate that. What do you think?
Yes, Pastor, so what we do is very important. In fact, I'm not saying this for us to raise our shoulders and feel more important than those who preach the word, but music is very important. I'll still go by the first line of the hymn again that says, I will sing. For me, it's a call for us to use a particular medium to talk about the story of the cross, which means music is very, very important. As you were giving your comments, you said that people give homilies, they share the word of God and, you know, ideas, sort of go and come and that kind of thing. But when you are inspired to write a song, you see how the song stays for a long time through generations, which means it's a way that we can use also to talk about or to back the story of God, which is completed on the cross. So music for me is very, very important. I like the way the man said, I will sing. He could have said, I will tell the wondrous story. Somewhere there he says it, but he begins, opens the song by saying, I will sing. I think that he is also, you know, looking at the power of music. Here, I think that the word sing here stands for music. Of course, it does. Music. I'll use the power of music to talk about the wondrous story of Christ who died for me. So this is a call on all of us who are worship leaders, who are musicians, to see the power of music as a gift from God that we can use to back the message of the cross so that many will come to know Christ and have the peace that he offers.
This is so powerful. I think all too soon, our time is up. I think it's important that you said it in your opening remarks, that every singer should see this as an anthem. Mm-hmm. Every musician should see this hymn as an anthem. Yes. I think it's so right. Yes. To come back and realize our worth in the kingdom, mm-hmm. in the body of Christ. Because mm-hmm. it's sad that somehow we are rather suppressed. It's like people now feel second class, to be called singers. Mm-hmm. They'd mm-hmm. rather want to be called, anything but singer. And yet from the revelations that are coming out from this discussion, you realize that singing is so important to the Lord. I can't count how many times in Psalms it says sing mm-hmm. unto the Lord. Sing.
Mm-hmm.
It means that we have we are very important in the body. Mm-hmm. And to think that even the glimpse of heaven that we've been given is that singing continues there.
Yes.
And
Pastor, that's what makes you, I don't mean to cut you, but that's what makes you so special, because you preach the word of God and you sing it at the same time. So we have to keep people like that in prayer all the time, because what you can do, only you can do, what only you can do, it will take about 10 people preaching for 3 months to do. If you do one ministration one time, preaching the word and singing at the same time with the gift that God has given you, it's so powerful.
Mm-hmm. No, it's interesting you bring this up. When I was at Akrofi Christola, mm-hmm. We have we have devotions, and so those of us studying, everybody is scheduled, one Wednesday to come and lead devotion, and so more or less come and give us an exhortation, And it got to my turn. And for some reason, 2 days prior to that devotion, people kept knocking at my door that, Charlie, you must sing. and I'm like, but we are all preaching, we are all teaching. He said, no. You must sing.
No, you have to sing. You must sing,
And so for some reason, I woke up in the morning, picked my acoustic bass guitar, and then a soundtrack that I had, and then set up. And that day, everybody came for devotion.
Look at that.
Everybody came for devotion because, Neoka is going to sing today. And the power of God during that, I didn't teach, I didn't preach. Yeah. I just picked some of my songs, and as I was singing, people were weeping. I mean, these are professors. They were just weeping because the word of God was just coming out.
Yeah.
And that was when I realized what has been entrusted into my care. And after that day, I didn't allow anybody to look down on me as a singer.
Not at all. No.
I don't need any accolade. I don't need any.
No.
If you like, give me 5 minutes. Let me sing.
Yes, give me 5 minutes.
Yes. And I realized the power of singing. So from that day onwards, when I go for seminars, I tell them that I know people have taught you, you are not a singer, you're a worshiper. You are not a singer. Look, guys.
Guys, this
thing called singing is very spiritual, very powerful. It's a single attribute that is able to transport somebody from the natural to the metaphysical.
Yes.
In an instant.
Yes. Yes.
You see? And so don't joke with this gift called singing.
Yes. Yes, that's true. But many a times I think that the problem comes when we don't know what we are singing, or when we are not sure what we are singing. And so the hymnist again is calling us that if it barks, you see, the message of the cross itself is so powerful. Yeah. And music is also a powerful vehicle. So when you use it well to bark it, then a lot of great things will happen. As you are describing of the experience at a Groupon. Yeah. So I like that, something that Paul said here in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 7. Mm. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 7. Paul says something here. This guy is not a musician, as you know. He's an evangelist.
Yeah.
So I was surprised that he used music in this lesson here.
He said,
even in the case of lifeless things that make sounds, such as pipe or harp, how will anyone know what tune is being played unless there's a distinction in notes?
Mm.
The clarity, and here we are talking about the word. Sometimes we are not clear about what it is that we are doing. So I think that, again, this hymn calls on us that for music to do its work, for music to do its work in what God is trying to do, it has to back the message of the cross.
Mm.
It has to back the message of the cross. And when it does, because that message itself, when we talk about the cross, we are not only limiting it to the cross or the crucifix, as you see it, or the cross as it happened here or there. But we are talking about the whole of the Bible as it backs, as you know, it is... it backs the message of the cross as it's fulfilled in the message of the cross. If we use music to back that powerful message, then great things will happen. So I think this hymn is a call on us to do something with the word of God by the use of music.
Wow. Wow. So we should sing the word.
Yes,
I like that. We should sing the word. All too soon, we are at the end of our discussion. But I want you to let our listeners know what is new in if I may, Newlove Annan Ministries. What you are up to? What we should look out for, and all that. Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, Ataa Nii, that's very good. These days, I am more about training young people and, you know, imparting knowledge, sharing what we know already. We also have a music program here at Wisconsin International University.
Okay.
Where we do courses like church music, audio recording, film music, music production, and things of that nature. We have great, great, great teachers who teach here. And so I am more about imparting knowledge to people. And as I've told you so many times, my interest is in church music, just as your interest is in that area too, how we can use music effectively to back the word and the work of God has been my interest. So anytime there's a discussion anywhere, you can invite me, anyone can invite me to be a part of it, because we are all sort of gathering the knowledge over here. As you went to a Groupon, I think that you know, because you did more about missions. These days, everybody says that Africa is a
heartland. Yeah, a major heartland for
the most fertile ground for evangelism and for the work of God and that kind of thing. So we should also start talking about our music and the part that music plays in worship, and how music can even help us to make the work easier as a tool on our hands. So if anybody is having any discussion or anything anywhere concerning music in worship or anything of that nature, any of the related areas like that, you can invite me and I'll be a part of that discussion as we put such information and knowledge together for future generations.
Powerful, 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 powerful. So how about the Evangel Choir and your recordings? Do you have anything online, any websites, anything that anybody wants to follow your music? Or if anybody wants to record your music.
I'm going to, Music, yes. Anybody wants to record my music, they should see Ataa Nii, and Ataa Nii will direct them to me, and I'll do that. Yes. So I have a couple of songs that I've written in the style of Your Grace and Mercy and those kinds of these days. I write a lot of such songs. So if anybody wants songs to record or things like that, they can come and I can give them a couple of them to listen to them. If they like them, they will record them. Wow. So I do that too.
That's a blessing. That's a blessing. So thank you so much, Reverend Newlove, again for being a blessing.
Thank you.
I honestly feel that we should do this many times.
because the
depth of information, you know, and the Holy Spirit just comes through as we speak. You know, touching on very vital areas that people need, in this walk. And I think it's very, very important. And I feel that others are also inspired to study by hearing you.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
They are gifted,
yes,
but they need to study so that they can build on their gifts. And the words you actually use, their music can back the word. You know, it's been a refreshing time spending this hour with you. God bless you so much.
Yes. God bless you too, Pastor.
And I want to thank your technical team who helped you at the other side, you know, and ours too. Our technical
Billy Selassie and Ima.
And then our technical team to Julius and Samuel and then Carla in the background. And if anybody also wants to support this work, you want to advertise your products and all that, just look at the number that's scrolling down the screen and then get in touch, and then we'll push things out there. One thing that music does is that it attracts a lot of following, so that whatever you have also can be advertised properly, so that it can be a blessing to you. Aside your soul prospering, you shall also prosper in other things. Amen.
Yes.
So thank you very much. So to round it all off, before I play the rendition again, if you have a word of prayer you want to share with those watching us, you know, then when you are done, I'll just play the rendition again and then we'll be done with this broadcast.
All right. Thank you very much, Ataa Nii. Let's pray then. Dear Lord, we thank you for being with us. We know that sometimes it is difficult to use human words to express those things that you have done, such as what you did on the cross. But we know that you, who are able to turn even earthly element into your blood and body, is also able to transform whatever we have heard here today into a divine and a spiritual discourse. Let us live here today, refilled, rejuvenated for the work ahead. And again, let the cross continue to be in our view wherever we are, to be thankful for what you have done for us, and to respond to your call to make the message of the cross also known to other people. I pray particularly for Pastor Neo Kai, for the ministry that he's doing, that the sun will not smite him by day, neither the moon by night.
Amen.
Protect him wherever he is and lead him to where you have destined him to be. We pray for the technical team. We pray for everyone who is connected to this program. Let this program grow from strength to strength, so that many people will come to know you through this effort. This and many blessings we have asked in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Let's go and have the rendition again from Gifty Asaam.
I'll sing of the wondrous story of Jesus who died for me. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me. How he left his home story of the lost, but Jesus found me, found the sheep that went astray, raised me up and gently led me back into the narrow way. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, singing with the saints in glory, gathered by the crystal sea. Dying on the cross for me. Hallelujah. Hey, yeah. I was bruised, but Jesus healed me. From many a fall, sight was gone, and fears possessed me, but He freed me from them all. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous story of the Christ. Days of darkness still come o'er me, sorrow's paths I often tread, but the Savior still is with me. By His hand I'm safely led. Hallelujah. Yes, I'll sing your story of the Christ who died for me, singing with the saints in glory, gathered by the crimson sea. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And all that is within me praises Holy Name. Hallelujah.
He will keep me till the river rolls its waters at my feet. Then He'll bear me safely over. Yes, I'll sing the wondrous No sea.